I'm going to start. I watched The Queen's Gambit. I haven't finished it yet, but it's good telly. It's really good telly. I just wondered about the initial attraction for you to get involved in this project when you first got the screenplay.
Yeah. Well, Scott, director, he got in touch with me. We worked together on another show called Godless in 2016, a couple of years back. And I had a great, great, great time on that. It was just lovely being around a writer, director who just knew how to bring something together and write for quite a large ensemble cast. And he just knows how to tell a story, I thought, very well. So when he got back in touch with me last year about this idea to play a chess champion in his new idea, before I'd even read the script, I knew I wanted to do it. And he asked me to grow my facial hair, and I ended up looking quite a lot like the other character that I played before in Godless. But it was I was on board. I think he just knows how to pull a story together, and that's all that matters, really.
And of course, you're working opposite the brilliant Anya Taylor-Joy, who's great in this. When because like you mentioned, it's a fantastic ensemble, and you've been involved in ensemble cast before, full of like great talent. How much does that kind of raise everyone's game when you've got just not just a kind of lead central character or lead role who's obviously so brilliant, but when you've got a whole collective of talent, it must make such a sort of great working environment to be involved in.
Oh, it really does. I mean, and that goes down to the key crew as well, which were again from Godless. So, you know, Stephen Meisler, our DOP, is fantastic. That's what I love about being on a film set, really. You're just surrounded by very talented people who are just very good at what they do. And it forces you to raise your game to be just as good as they are. If you're walking onto a set that's just out of this world and incredible and the attention to detail is beautiful, you've got to make sure that you do that set justice by bringing it to life and making it seem like it's your apartment or wherever it's supposed to be. And the acting side of things was, I mean, yeah, everyone in the show is fantastic, I think. And when you're around talent, it's infectious, I think. And it raises everyone's game.
How much do you miss that kind of buzz at the moment of the kind of, you know, because obviously, I mean, for so many people, we all miss the kind of big communal things, but I've been on film sets and there is a special type of buzz on a film set because there's so many people working so hard to bring this story to life. And there's just something quite brilliant and very collective about those circumstances. Obviously this year, there's been so few of those opportunities. Is that something you've missed quite a lot? Just the being around people and that kind of buzz you get from being involved in something.
Yeah, that's normally the main thing that I miss, actually, is from not being on film set for a while, is that community sense and that buzz, like you said, that you pick up from that. I do miss that. Try and find that in other walks of life, but it's not ever quite the same. It's never as concentrated. Everyone knows that they're only there for a limited amount of time and everyone is focused on one story, telling this one story, and that's it. So even if you work with the same people like we did, Queen's Gambit and Godless felt like very different film sets, even though there were a lot of the same people, but it felt vastly different. So you're aware in that moment that you're only ever, that once that moment is done, then that's it. It moves on and it can never be repeated ever again. So you're very kind of conscious of the moment. And that's just a good practice anyway. And then when you're all done with it, you know, you hang up your costume and you walk away and you never kind of, unless there's a sequel, you never really kind of come back to that character again. So I do love that. It's a special moment in time that can never really be repeated again. And it's what I love about acting.
Yeah, but it's funny because despite the fact that, like you said, they feel like they're unique experiences that can't be repeated, when you do make something that does require you come back, let's say like The Maze Runner, where there's like more than one, or if you get like the Game of Thrones, where you have to be back on set over time, do they still feel different to the last, even if it's involved in the kind of same franchise or same story?
Yeah, they do. They always do, which is kind of lovely, really. I mean, with The Maze Runners as well, we shot one in Louisiana, one in Albuquerque, and one in Cape Town, South Africa. So our crews were very different, but our cast was all the same, and we were put up in very similar kind of hotels and very similar kind of lodging, and same characters, same kind of costumes, same directors and stuff, but they take on their own personality, And I think that kind of just comes from the time in which you're shooting it, the moment in which you're present.
And I'm just going to ask as well, are you any good at chess? Is that something you're good at in real life?
I'm okay. And I know how to play the game. And I got a little bit better from this show, but not much really. I enjoy it. I do enjoy it. I enjoy the thought process behind it all. And yeah, just how cerebral it is. But I'm not that great.
I'm more of a Connect Four man myself. But this program does explore the kind of true cost of being a genius in many regards. I just wondered, do you think you've ever encountered a genius in your through your profession? Is there anyone you've ever worked with or been on set with, or anyone that you've kind of met where you just thought, I think I might have just been in the presence of an actual genius?
Yes. Probably several. Sometimes it's hard to really tell. They might be genius within a certain kind of realm or a certain aspect, but I mean, the one that jumps to mind would be Mark Rylance, working with him on Wolf Hall. He's just had a special demeanor about him as an individual, as a person. He's a very gentle, loving, kind person. And seeing how he used that to go in and out of his character and his world that he was supposed to be in was really quite a majestic, slow, beautiful process. It wasn't too labor intensive or overly focused, even though it required huge amounts of focus. I mean, it was just I just loved spending time with him. I found him like a fascinating creature and an amazing actor.
Yeah. Now, I've interviewed him before, and when you make eye contact, this sounds so ridiculous, but he really makes you feel like you're like the only person in the room. Like, he listens to everything you say.
Yes.
It's an incredible conversation. Meeting Mark. Because I was wondering too, because obviously, you know, you've been in this industry for such a long time now, so much of your life. I just wondered if it's quite surreal for yourself to have watched yourself, be able to watch yourself kind of grow up on screen, and what that's been like for you as someone who's been involved in the industry since you were a child. If it's quite strange, if you ever revisit old projects, to have seen yourself kind of grow up in the public eye like that, and what that's like.
Yeah, it is strange. It's kind of like going through a photo album or something. I mean, I haven't watched old stuff for a long, 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 long time. But every now and again, you know, Love Actually comes on, and I'll catch like 10 minutes of it or so, and I'll see the little person that I used to be. And you know, I still remember what it was like from my point of view at that moment. And you know, I thought that I was pretty grown up, pretty experienced, knew what I was doing. I wasn't that plussed about it. I was used to it and fine with it. And yeah, I just looked like such a small child, which I was. But it's quite nice, really. Yeah, it churns up memories, and they'll forever be held on on digital format or film or whatever. So they'll always be there. So it is quite nice, really.
Yeah, because most people, I guess, they kind of decide what they want to do at kind of 18, 19. But when you got in, because you effectively started your career so young, was there a kind of feeling when you were that age of, this is what I want to do? Or did you still go through that process when you were kind of 17, 18, of having a think about what your career is going to be? Or do you think in some ways it had already been decided in your mind?
A bit of both, really. I kind of fell into it because it was something that I thought would be fun to do, and it ended up kind of snowballing a bit, and I ended up just kind of getting job after job after job. But I was still a child, and still very much at school and just enjoying playing with my Lego and everything that a child does. So I didn't take it that seriously, which I think helped actually with booking jobs, was that I didn't take it too seriously. And it also helped protect myself from the first experiences of rejection and all the kind of quite hard things to deal with within an industry that's as cutthroat as this one at a young age. The fact that I'd kind of, it's all right, I could kind of take it in my stride helped quite a lot. But no, when I hit 16, 17, and school forces you to kind of start thinking about your future and what you want to do and what qualifications and all that stuff, I realized I was already doing something that I loved and something that, well, apparently people said I was quite good at, and paid me too. That's a job. So I kind of started focusing a bit more on that and taking it a little bit more seriously. But every now and again, I have to take myself back to when I was 10, 12, and I didn't take things so seriously. Sometimes that's the better way. So I think there are certainly lessons that I could have only learned from being a child in this industry that I still look back on, and they still help me. And a lot of people think that being a child actor must, you know, mess you up. And I can certainly see how it could do. It has the potential to do some quite horrible things, but it's also got the potential to be really quite fantastic. And it taught me an awful lot at a young age, just about all sorts of things that were fascinating. I mean, when I first got into it, we were filming on film, so I would learn how to change the gate, how to reload the film, and they'd give me B camera to play around with and play with zooms. I learned about lenses, I learned about exposure, lighting, and or if you do a period piece, you know, I remember learning lots about the Romans and World War II and stuff, and I'd come back to school and I'd know more than the teachers would about certain aspects of it, because you just delve into such detail. But you're also very flippant, and you're just a little kid that doesn't really care at the same time. So that aspect can be very useful later on as things pile up in a scene and you start overthinking and trying to hit every mark and trying to focus in too much, and you end up losing the scene. If you go back to being a kind of carefree child, you end up giving it all away, and you end up with a much better performance, better take.
I imagine that must be the case, because I mean we sort of forget about that, what it really is, but acting is the world of make-believe, isn't it? It's play.
Yeah. Keep playing. Yeah.
Yeah. Did you feel a bit like a kid when you were on the set of Star Wars?
Absolutely. I think
how was that experience for you, just to be involved in a machine like as big as that? And it must have, because I mean Star Wars is so cinematic, to have seen stormtroopers walking past, it must have been sort of so crazy to have been involved in that.
It was. I was a big fan of Star Wars. It was my thing when I was a kid. I was a Star Wars fan, particularly the originals. And so yeah, when that opportunity came up to come in, do one day, didn't even know really what the part was. I was just like, yes, of course. I have to be in Star Wars. That's my dream, really. And so yeah, walking on a set, and all the other actors that I was with during my little scene were just exactly like me, and we, you know, our age range was all over the place, but we all turned into little 12-year-old boys as soon as we walked on that set, and we were in costume. We were just kind of pinching each other going, where the hell are we? This is amazing. And even the cameras, you know, were all custom made black cameras with 35mm back on, and I hadn't seen that in years. Star Wars cameras. And the sets and all the lights and everything. It was just very, very exciting. And seeing saw the cockpit of a TIE fighter, and I saw a section of Millennium Falcon, and yeah, just a little boy.
Yeah, because it's interesting because you're talking about sort of just even from a young age being interested in some of the more technical side of things. Is that, do you reckon that could lend itself one day into you directing and getting into that side of things? Have you ever given yourself that much thought about? Because I mean, to have been privy to all those kind of technical elements at such a young age, I guess it must give you quite a, I don't know, kind of an all-round kind of perspective on the way the industry all works. And can you see yourself exploiting that one day?
Yeah, I can. I'm not sure when or how, or it would have to be the right piece at the right time. But it certainly is something that interests me. I'm fascinated by the whole process and everything that has to work in order for it to be effective as a piece. And that relies on just getting the right people in at the right time and making it all work. And yeah, I mean, I find it fascinating. We'll see. Hopefully.
So because I was looking at like what's next, because I always like check to see what projects you've got coming up. And I obviously noticed still on IMDb, because it probably hasn't been updated, is the Mouse Guard film, which obviously was
still on there.
Which obviously was the abandoned movie between them and the Disney and Fox thing took
place.
I'm just interested to know how far your involvement went in that. Had you worked on it? Had you actually been involved and worked on it? And what does it feel like to have been involved in something that we'll never see the light of day? Because I know that there was like a 10-minute thing of it that went out, didn't it? That kind of
were
able to watch. But had they made pretty much the whole thing?
They'd made a lot. And what they sent me, because I mean, I knew Wes because he directed the Maze Runner movies, and he had this idea of doing this mouse guard thing, and really saw me as this character, and it, you know, I'd love to work with him. I think he has an amazing imagination. I was really intrigued to see what he did after Maze Runner as well. Those were his first ever movies. And I'm not a huge fan of motion capture, but I think for a story like this, it would have worked really, really well. So no, I was really looking forward to it. And then they sent me this little kind of sizzle reel or whatever it was. I couldn't believe like how amazing the quality was and how far they'd already got. And then when I spoke to Wes and he took me through some of the artwork, the amount of time and effort and thought and illustrations that had been put into this piece was really quite amazing. I think I heard it got cancelled the night before I was supposed to fly out. So I was all packed up, ready to jump on the plane and fly out for like a week or two of prep and then get into it. It can just all fall apart so easily.
You found out the night before you flew and not the night after. My final question, and I know obviously IMDb needs to take that off your upcoming projects, but what is upcoming? Have you got anything in the pipeline, or have you been, what's it, even just over lockdown, have you found yourself doing many auditions and stuff? Has it felt?
No, it kind of dried up quite for a bit when people just kind of didn't really know what was going on really. Now it seems to have opened up. I mean, there is stuff that's being filmed. I have friends that are filming, and I think everyone else is just kind of looking at what is filming and seeing how it works, what you need to do, what's necessary, and where you can shoot, who you can shoot with, and how it all kind of can come together and work. So I think it's just kind of a process of trying to figure out how to continue to make movies and TV in this current climate. But yeah, it's encouraging. I'm getting a few self-tapes and auditions through now for projects that are set to go next year. We'll just see what happens. It's a bit all up in the air at the moment, really.
Brilliant. Well, thanks so much for your time today, Tom. It's been a real pleasure speaking to you.
All right, cheers, man. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're watching Hey You Guys!
Hey You Guys, huh?
Hey You Guys,
is that from the Goonies?
It is indeed, yes.
Nice. Hey!